Today's scripture lesson is from Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Acton Methodist Church. It's good to see everyone here this morning. My name is Wade, and I'm the lead pastor of the church here. If you are a guest of ours today, thank you all for being here. We really do appreciate it. And we hope and pray that you have a great experience of God's grace while you were on campus. We also want to make sure that we welcome those who are worshiping with us online. So welcome to you as well. When you walked in, we want to make sure that you got one of these. This is the worship guide. It has an order of worship for today. And there's got some other pieces of information that I just want to touch on briefly this morning. One is the tear-off strip. If you'll tear off that tear-off strip right now, we would greatly appreciate it. You can fill that out and let us know whether you are a regular attendee or a guest of ours today, who you are and how we can come alongside of you. That'd be fantastic. We would appreciate that. You'll also see on the backside other announcements. You'll see that Active Celebrates America is coming up on July 3rd. We would love for you to go ahead and plan on being here that night. If you've signed up to volunteer or you will be signing up to volunteer, there is a meeting today at 12:15 in room A4 that we would love for you to come and participate in. This is a community outreach event, and I know that many of you will be here to take it all in, but we'd love for you to also to sign up to hold open a door for someone, to greet people, because we have people all over the community that are coming here, and I want them to leave knowing that they've encountered Christian people who love them extravagantly, and that can't happen unless you're helping. So thank you ahead of time for agreeing to do that. You'll also see that Mega Sports Camp is starting tomorrow, and we have a video that I would like to play that's about Mega Sports Camp. It's a little bit different than normal Vacation Bible School, but it still has Vacation Bible School elements in it. And I want to play the video just in case you weren't here last week and you have kids and grandkids who have not yet signed up. So let's play the video. And it does have sound. Okay, here's the theme of the video. There you go. Here's the theme of the video. Y'all repeat after me. Mega.
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 Mega Sports Camp.
Mega Sports Camp.
That's it. It's really high energy. It meets kids where they are with their playing sports. We use that as an avenue to talk about Jesus and their walk with Christ. And so we're really excited about it. We've had a large number of pre-registrations. And I'm really excited about this. Over half the people or the kids who signed up for VBS or Mega Sports Camp this year do not attend this church. They're people in the community, and I'm really, really excited about that so that we can minister to them more effectively. If you have not yet signed up or you want to sign up to be a volunteer, you can do so. This morning at the 9:45 service, we recognized people that had volunteered. I think we have a picture of that that's coming up soon. No, you know what? There's a picture in space somewhere of the group that came forward, and we recognized and prayed over them. But we have a large number of volunteers that have signed up, and we still would love to have you participate and do that even more so. If you open up your worship guide, there's some information that we want you to be aware of as well. Condolences are in order for Candy Kane. Her mother recently passed away, and we want to remember Candy in our prayers. If you know Candy, don't just think about her or pray for her, reach out to her. Also, that's who we are as Christian folk. But then there are some congratulations that are in order as well for those who are celebrating wedding anniversaries. And as I read each name, I would invite you to respond the way that you would want people to respond if your name was being read out in church. So to John and Wilma Tibbs, who are celebrating their 62nd wedding anniversary. James and Shirley Boylan are celebrating number 60. Terry and Susie Gray are celebrating number 59. Craig and Faye Fisher are celebrating number 57. Larry and Sharon Clark are celebrating number 54. And Ed and Sally Vela are celebrating number 38. So we can give God thanks for them. If you know of others that are celebrating anniversaries, please let the church know at any time. And if there's any other reason we can celebrate, please let us know. We are to celebrate with those who are celebrating and mourn with those who are mourning. So please let us know. We're so glad that everyone is here. At this time in the service, would you please stand up and find a stranger, not family, not friends, but find someone you haven't said hi to and greet them with the love of Christ.
The Lord is indeed in this place. The Spirit makes us dwelling in here, and this is a safe space where you can come and you can freely confess anything to God and know that you can be forgiven. So in that spirit, I invite you to just take a few quiet moments with God and confess whatever you need to lay before the Lord this morning. And now with humble hearts, let us pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Hear the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. As we continue in our prayers today, we want to take a moment and pray for Mega Sports Camp. Our vacation Bible school is this week, and we are so excited about that. Some of you may say, well, I don't have the time or the ability, or it's too late to volunteer, but all of you can pray. You can pray at any hour of the day that you think about this camp. You can pray for the participants. You can pray for the volunteers. You can pray for those who are coming to this church for the first time. It's really hard to walk into a place that's new. And so we just need to pray for everyone who comes to receive and understand the love of Jesus in a brand new way. So I invite you to pray for them today, but I also ask that you pray for Mega Sports Camp all week whenever you think about it. God can do amazing things when we pray. I also invite you to lift up whatever is on your heart today, any joys or concerns, and as we do, we'll respond together. Lord, hear our prayers. So what can we pray for this morning? Lord, hear our prayers. 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 Gracious and loving God, what a comfort it is to know that before we even ask, you are already with us. Lord, we pray today for those that we have lifted up to you. Some of us have responded immediately with a prayer, and some of us hold secret requests and secret needs in our hearts that we're afraid to voice out loud. But regardless of how we come to you, we know that you receive our prayers and that you love each person, each individual in the situations that we have lifted up. For you have created each uniquely in their mother's womb, and you know what they need in order to understand your presence. So give comfort or healing, strength, guidance, whatever each person needs, Lord. We ask that you would show them that you are there. And we pray that by the Holy Spirit, they would respond to you, that they would welcome your love, that they would allow you to comfort them, that you would be the great healer, Lord. We love you and we trust in you in every part of our lives, in life, in death, and in life beyond death. You always have the last word, God. And so we proclaim boldly today that we are your beloved children and we will follow you where you lead us. Give us a spirit of affirmation today as we come today opening our hearts and desiring to draw closer to you. Pour out your spirit, Lord, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
At this time in the service, we have an opportunity to state what it is that we believe. And this is not just another item in the worship service. This is something that we get to join in with Christians all around the world who are stating on this very day or this weekend what it is that they believe about God. We stand in alignment with those practicing Christians around the globe who are worshiping God this morning. We also stand in a stream of 2,000 years of faith to say once again, on this day, this is what we believe and this is what we lean into. So let's all join together in affirming what it is that we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As our ushers prepare to come forward today, I just want to remind you how God is just moving through this church. Now, we had a youth group, senior high mission trip, went to New Mexico this week to make a difference in people's lives, and they came back late last night, and everyone did great. They came back safe, and most of those youth, even after a long, long trip from New Mexico to Granbury yesterday, they were up and at church this morning. And when you doubt what God's doing through the youth, just keep that in mind, and we're so thankful to be a part of that in this church. And thank you to you who've volunteered and prayed for them, but also gave money for them. Junior high mission trip is coming up in July, so you'll have another opportunity to do that as well. As Amy said earlier, Mega Sports Camp is something that we're really excited about, and to be able to host several people in the community who perhaps don't have a church home, but they've stepped out in faith to be part of this Mega Sports Camp. We have a great opportunity to make an impact on them, to help them see Jesus. You are a part of that, and so thank you for that as well. Same thing with Acton Celebrates America. That's something we should be very proud of on that. It costs about $4,500 a day to operate as a church. If the motivation for changed lives doesn't motivate some of you, maybe that dollar figure will. It costs about $4,500 a day for us to operate as a church, to make a difference in people's lives. For those of you who've given sacrificially up to this point this year, thank you. You've claimed this as your church home, and you've given sacrificially so ministries to youth and people in the community can happen. For those of you who are partners of this church and have not yet started giving, we encourage you to do so. God's doing something in this church, and we want to encourage you to make an investment and to follow up with that vow that you took when you joined the church. One last request. Several of you wait to give to the church to the very end of the year. And we want to encourage those that do that, if you would consider making your gift to the church in July. As you know, summer is here, and people are in and out during the summer in ways that they're not during the rest of the year. And it's a funny thing, when people aren't here, their money isn't either. They take it with them. And so if you are willing and you are able to give to in July when you normally give in December, would you pray about that and consider it? We're not asking because we're in desperate need. We're asking so that we don't have to come to you in desperate need. So would you prayerfully consider that? Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your provision and for your abundance and for being the author of new life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It shines so clear.
So thankful for the choir. They're singing through July 1st, and Acton celebrates America. And then I think, if I understand right, they're taking the next few weeks in July. Not till Christmas. Do not listen to Ken. No, they'll be back first week of August, right? First week of August. So we're so thankful for their ministry. Look, let's talk about this morning. Why does it seem that, like, everyone gets so angsty about everything these days? Why does it seem like people get so angsty about everything these days? If you're not familiar with that term, angsty is just the way in which you operate through life. You're anxiety filled. You have apprehension. You're nervous. You fear the future, and that angsty is where you were living that out and how you operate. It's kind of like a nervous kitten or someone who's backed into the corner. You come out fighting all the time. Why is it that people seem to be so angsty about everything these days? You know, politics, people are always angsty about politics. There's nothing new under the sun. Even back in George Washington's day, I'm a student of history. If you go back to George Washington's day, it was crazy how angsty they were back then, even with George Washington and what they would say about politics. And if you didn't agree with them, even back in that day, they would call the opposing people all kinds of names to get their point across that they were right and they were wrong. There's really nothing new under the sun except the volume and the speed of which politics enters into our homes now. You know, back in Washington's day, newspapers had to travel far before the news got there, a day or two later. Now we have it within a minute. And so we don't have time to let things settle down. We don't ponder on things. We don't have time to process things. It's 1 minute after the other, after the other, after the other. So with the border crisis that was here this last week, look, for many of us, we're up in arms about that. For others of you, you're like, I haven't had time to even pay attention to the news, so I'm not that anxious filled about that. But some of you are anxious about the church. Maybe not our particular church, but maybe it's the church overall. There's some decisions that are being made potentially about some things. I'll talk about that a little bit later. But even some of you may be going, I'm not anxious about the church either. Everything's perfectly fine here. What is there to be anxious about? Some of you are anxious about your families. You may not have time to think about politics. That'd be a luxury, actually. And you really don't have time to think about the church. You just need to know the church is going to be here for you, and this is a safe place for you. Fantastic. But you have family matters that are just causing you to live with anxiety, that you're full of apprehension, that you're nervous, that you fear the future. Maybe because of your role in that. Maybe it's because of someone in your family that's doing something that's beyond your control. And what happens when we are angsty is we can get backed into a corner. And how we would normally respond to things, like on a scale of 1 to 10, we'd be like at a 1 or 2. When we are filled with anxiety and we are angsty, the simplest thing can turn it up to an 11 really quickly. And we go full nuclear on people that we feel threatened by or have a different opinion. But how does God lead us through those angsty moments? How does God lead us through those times when we want to respond just the way the rest of the culture does and our strong opinions about things? How is God leading us to take a step back and to ponder things a little bit differently so that we would be empowered to respond as faithful people? How does God lead us to do that? Or are we even supposed to be different than the rest of the world? And the answer is yes. And the Holy Spirit empowers us to understand that a little bit more. The early church wrestled with this as well in Paul's letter to the Galatians. This is the scripture that's printed in your worship guide. Here's what he says, and granted, I want you to hear this. He's not writing to outsiders. He's not writing to people in general. He's writing to Christians who needed to be reminded who they were and to whom they belonged. It's funny, even 2,000 years later, we still need reminding as to who we are and to whom we belong. So here's what Paul says. So I say, and y'all are going to help me out here. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Okay, you already see there's a difference between walking in the Spirit and walking according to the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit is contrary to the flesh. There is conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. How does the Holy Spirit enable us to go through these angsty times? And actually, how does the Holy Spirit enable us to play well with others, even when we may not have an agreement with them? How does the Holy Spirit enable us to play well with others? So here's the prayer that I would love to invite you to pray as we go into this sermon time. I want to share it with you, and then maybe we can pray it together. The prayer goes like this. Lord, I need help playing well with others. People get on my nerves. Lead me by your Spirit in your ways. If that's a prayer that you can pray, let's all pray it together. Lord, I need your help playing well with others. People get on my nerves. Lead me by your Spirit in your ways. Some of you needed to pray that prayer that didn't. But we trust that the Holy Spirit will move through this, okay? So what can we do to understand how God empowers us to play well with others? Especially if you go back and look at what Paul said to the Galatians. The first thing that we need to remember is that we need to receive the power that God offers us. That's what Paul was telling the early Christians. He said, look, you can't hope to live by the Spirit unless you've received the Spirit. That you can't hope to live in the ways of Jesus, if you want to talk about our modern day age. You can't hope to live in the ways of Jesus until you've received Jesus. If Jesus is just someone that you admire, if Jesus is just someone that you respect from afar, but Jesus is never that person that you follow, then you will never walk in the ways of Jesus. Faith is active, not passive. And Paul was saying to the early Christians who knew who Jesus was, who were trying to walk in faith, but need to be reminded, look, to live by the Spirit, you have to receive that power of the Spirit, that power that Jesus promised all his disciples. In fact, we understand in Acts chapter 1 that Jesus had died and he had appeared to his disciples. And when he appeared to these disciples, they were hidden away. They were scared because the one whom they had been following for 3 years had just died a really horrible death, and he'd been placed in a tomb. But then the resurrected Jesus appeared to these disciples, these fishermen, these tax collectors, these people that were probably not well-educated at all, that didn't have strong public relations ties, that were probably not very eloquent at all. Some of them were extroverts. Some of them were introverts. Some of them were filled with high anxiety. Some of them were kind of just went with the flow. They were just actually like you and me. But the resurrected Jesus appeared to them in their midst like the resurrected Jesus appears here. And here's what he says when they asked him the question, are you going to set everything right now? And here's what Jesus says. He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. So essentially what he's saying is, your job's not done yet. We're not going to wrap this thing up in a nice little bow yet. You still have work to do. You still need to exercise your faith because the world's going to be transformed by what I can do in and through you. And here's what he goes on to say. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to all the ends of the earth. So when Jesus was saying that Holy Spirit power is a promise that they would all need and that they would soon receive, he was saying that they would receive that power to enable them to break through their anxiety, to break through their angstiness, to break through their apprehension, to break through their fear, to make an impact on someone else. You see, that's what's interesting. Jesus empowers them to play well with others. He empowers them and gives them words to speak. Now, you know as well as I do that communication isn't just about the meaning of words. It's about how those words are communicated. You're picking up right now, not just what I say, but how I say it. That's just communication one-on-one. Nonverbals mean just as much as the verbals. So when I read this passage, it isn't just about the disciples being empowered to have the right thinking. He was also empowering them to have the right practice as well, that they were to go into a world that had one way of doing things, but he was empowering them to go into that world to help people see a different way. But they first had to receive that power that God was offering them, just like you do. That same promise and that same offer is for you, that you are to receive that offer that God has given you. There are not special first-class people who are the only ones who receive it, and then the rest of us are second-class people. No, there are no first or second class people in God's eyes. You are God's people. So this power that God is promising through Jesus to his disciples is that same power that's being offered to you today. to not just receive it so that you would feel less angsty, but to receive it so that others would feel less angsty and know their place in the world and who they are and to whom they belong. Paul also goes on to say this. He says that they need to understand that being led by the flesh is different than being led by the Spirit. Being led by the flesh, being led by my own wants and desires, you being led by your own wants and desires, those wants and desires that many times are contrary to God's grace. That there is a huge difference between being led by the flesh and being led by the Spirit of God. We are Spirit-filled people. That's who we were meant to be. That when we receive the grace of Jesus Christ and we are baptized in His grace, then that is meant to kickstart a lifetime of walking with Jesus where we are continually being filled by His Spirit because He loves us enough not to just leave us content with distant memories and fumes of when we were baptized or confirmed back decades ago. But He sends the promise of His Spirit so that we would walk with Him daily and not walk to the flesh that was supposed to have died when we were baptized. Now remember, Paul is speaking to the Christians in Galatia who've already received Jesus. But here's what he says to them. The acts of the flesh are obvious. So for those of you who want more clarity on really what God is calling you to do, Scripture, sometimes you read them and you go, I don't understand what's going on. I feel quite confident that if you pay attention to what Paul is saying here, you will know beyond a shadow of a doubt what the desires of the flesh are, and you'll be able to walk out informed, but also walk out empowered not to give into it. So the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality. Let me just, someone needs to hear this morning. If you're married and you think the Lord is leading you to have an affair with someone else, that's not the Spirit leading you. Something else is leading you, and it's not the Spirit. The flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft. But then get this, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy. Drunkenness, orgies, and the like. And here's what Paul says. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. You were created for more, and you were saved for more than just giving into your most base desires and wants. Look, you've been set apart and you've been redeemed. You've been set apart and you've been saved by the grace of Jesus Christ to live for something more than just your base desires and wants. You've been set apart to be a light in the darkness. You've been set apart to add a little God seasoning to this world that is devoid of any taste whatsoever. You have been set apart not just for your own self-interest, but for the interest of other people. In fact, you could say this. You have been empowered by the Spirit of God to play well with others. To not do that is to submit yourself and to succumb to the powers of the flesh. And we're not called to do that. In fact, let me put this in perspective for you so you might be engaged with this. Think about the last 5 days. Think about the last 5 days. How have you responded in the flesh with the way that Paul described it? How have you been led to respond to things in the way of the flesh as opposed to the way of the Spirit? When you've come across someone who's disagreed with you on your politics, how have you responded in the ways of the flesh? Not what I have said, but what Paul has said. Don't find a loophole to try to get out of this. With politics, with the border crisis, for example, with people who have a different opinion than you, how have you responded, not in the Spirit, but in flesh? Even if you are right or you feel very strongly about your position, how have you responded in the flesh? Remember, it's not just about what you think, it's about how you portray that. Think about your family. How would those of you, of those that are closest to you over the 5 days, how would they say that you responded to them and other family tensions and situations with the power of the flesh as opposed to the power of the Spirit? See, we're all tempted to do that, and we all do it. This is not a new story. Paul knew that back 2,000 years ago. We know it today. But never forget, the Holy Spirit empowers us to live differently than we are now because of the grace of Jesus Christ. In fact, Paul says this, it's not just about the power of the flesh, it's the overwhelming power of the Spirit that makes all the difference in the world. Get this. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. And if that was the only thing we had, then that would be fantastic. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience or forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are all fruits of the Spirit that are empowered by the Spirit as we play well with others. We either use our interaction with others as a display of our faith, or we let the world dictate how we're going to respond. The earliest Christians knew that if we walked with Christ, we would display Christ-like attributes. Even if we felt strongly about something, we would still proceed in love and not division and not setting up roadblocks. But we still feel convicted, but still practice self-control, for example. Against such things, there are no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us do what? Hey, Spirit-filled people, listen up. Since we live by the Spirit, let us what? About three-quarters of you don't believe that, nor do you want to say. I'm going to give you another opportunity here. Since we live by the Spirit, let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. Our walk with Christ and being empowered by the Spirit impacts how we play well with one another. Let me give you two examples. So if you haven't been engaged with the sermon yet, I bet you will here in just a few minutes. The first one is the border crisis. Now, I'm going to give you two extremes here. The first extreme is this. Look, we are a nation that's been divinely anointed by God, manifest destiny. This is a Christian nation. God's favor is upon us. Red, white, and blue all the way. And people are supposed to follow the laws. And so what happened with the kids down at the border crisis, look, it wasn't our problem. It was theirs. They shouldn't have tried to come into the nation illegally in the first place. Some of you feel very strongly about that. Fantastic. Others of you are the opposite way. You're going, look at these kids. Who cares what the laws are? Look at these kids. Aren't we supposed to do something? These laws are bad and we shouldn't follow them. So you got two extremes here. And when we respond that way, either or, black and white, in those situations, we become angsty. It becomes white noise because everyone is trying to yell louder than anyone else. Someone's trying to make that one comment in an internet stream to be the one that everyone blows up about. What we're doing is we're living anxious, filled lives without self-control. But let me say this. When we look at the border process, we should not look and see what the Democratic Party platform is first or the Republican Party platform is first. We should not use that primarily as our filter as to what is right or wrong or what's going to produce anxiety or not. The filter that we should look through as faithful Christians is, what does Scripture reveal about how we are to treat the least and the lost and families and children? What does long-term Christian tradition teach about that? Whether they broke the law or not, this is not a law issue. But how are we as Christians either supposed to turn up the temperature on the dialogue or add a little God seasoning to it, going, hey guys, let's put aside Trump for a little bit and let's put aside Hillary Clinton followers here for a little bit and let's just get to the basics here. How is Jesus leading us? And if your version of Jesus looks like Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, you're not following the right Jesus. Because what Jesus teaches us is meant to lower the anxiety level, not ratchet up. We can feel very strongly about something, but our role as Christians is to not turn up the heat to 11. It's to practice peace. It's to bring two different groups of people who may see things completely differently and go, hey, you're both very passionate about it. But where is Jesus leading us to this? We are to uphold our laws. That's who we are as Christians. But at the same time, we are to look out for the least and the lost. If we are a Christian nation, do we want the world looking at us as we thumb our nose at these kids? At the same time, as we look at these kids, do we want the world to think that we don't obey our laws? We need Christians to step up because they've been empowered by the Holy Spirit to stand in the gap and go, hey, everybody, maybe we're not talking about the right thing here. How can we as Christians set the stage for how this is being done instead of us being subjected to whatever the world is doing? See, if we respond just like the world does, then where's Jesus? If we're ratcheting up the comments like everyone else does, where's Jesus? This doesn't mean you don't feel passionate about something. It doesn't mean you don't stand up for something. But remember, it's not just about what you say. It's how you say it. And in how you saying it, is it giving God all the honor and glory, or are you getting all the honor and glory because you're putting someone in their place? Let's talk about the church for a little bit. We're part of an awesome denomination. It's a Methodist church. And some of us are kind of angsty about the Methodist church at this season of our lives because the Methodist church is assessing some things and discerning whether or not there's some changes that need to be made. So let me tell you the way things currently are. The way the current Methodist church does things, our norms and our mores and our values, we have stated very clearly that we are all people of sacred worth, not just us, but people out in the world, no matter who they are, skin color, height, weight, nationality, all people are of sacred worth. Sexuality, all people are of sacred worth. Everyone, there's no one outside of the realm of God's grace. Not one. The language is already there that says that. That's the understanding of which I was ordained into and of which I uphold and follow. I was also ordained and chose to follow out that pastors who are ordained will not be practicing homosexuals. That's one of the criteria, that if you are a practicing homosexual, you will not be open for ordination. There's also criteria for heterosexuals that don't reach certain criteria. They will not be ordained either. While we are sacred worth, practicing homosexuals will not be ordained, nor will any United Methodist pastor who's been ordained will we preside over same-sex weddings. Even though the law of the land says that any person can get married, the United Methodist Church, as it currently stands, says that no United Methodist Church clergy will preside over same-sex marriages. That's just how it is. That's what I was ordained in. Pastor Billy was ordained in that. He's retired now. But we were all ordained in that. We took those vows. There's a movement among some that wants to change the language. And that causes a lot of anxiety for a lot of people. And the language that's wanting to be changed, possibly proposed, is that we change the language of marriage, that it's not just a man and woman anymore, but now it's any consenting adults that United Methodist clergy, if this proposal perhaps would go through, then clergy could marry any same-sex couple. Also, it would change that language in the Book of Discipline to where it says it's not just a traditional understanding of marriage, but anyone could get married. And the United Methodist Church would be open to having practicing homosexuals who met those ordination standards be appointed to any local church. So that means that Acting United Methodist Church at one point could have pastors presiding over same-sex marriages or have a practicing homosexual as the pastor. Now, some of you hear that and you're ready to fight. You're ready to put your pole in the sand and go, this is a line we will not cross and let's go. I feel very strongly about where I stand on this. You may feel strongly about where you stand. For others of you, you just got your hair blown back a little bit because you're like, what in the world is going on here? But my encouragement to you is this, that we are to respond as people that have been empowered by the Spirit. I've had too many conversations in church world where if I didn't agree with that person, then I was an outcast. That even with the idea of tolerance around, if I didn't agree with them, they weren't very tolerant of that, and my legs were cut out from underneath me, and I was now the enemy. I've also seen that on the traditional side as well, that if someone doesn't agree with the traditional side, that person is no longer, you know, within their realm of grace. I want to encourage you to do this. One is to remember that until we are told otherwise, which may or may not ever happen, we're going to proceed as if all people are of sacred worth. And we're going to continue with the vows of which I was ordained about 20 years ago. Nothing has changed. But as we go through this process, which the executive lay leadership team is going through, as well as the big denomination, look, our number one goal is to play well with one another. Amen? We can disagree, and we can feel strongly about our disagreement. And there may be some point where I come down and say, this is where I stand as a pastor. And you're going to have to come to understand whether or not you're going to come out fighting or we're going to learn to play well with one another. But that's who we are as Christians. We are to be known by how we have been empowered and how we play well with one another. Now, if you want more information on that, if you want to talk with me about this or the border thing, I'd love to visit with you anytime about that. But the one rule that I will say that we'll play by is that we will play nice together. Because you're not going to steamroll me in my office, and I'm not going to steamroll you either. For others, for some of you, you're like, border crisis, I'm not have time for that. Others of you are like, church, I just want to come to church. I don't care whatever the decision is, I just want to come to church. Some of you are just angst-filled because of your family. I don't even know if I need to say anything else about that, because you're torqued up about your family. And instead of living a life of peace and of love and of joy and of patience and of goodness and of self-control, you're all torqued up. But the promise is still for you, whether it's politics or church or family. The promise of Jesus is the same, that you have been empowered by the Holy Spirit to have a non-anxious presence, to have that peace that surpasses all understanding, to be, once again, a little light in the darkness, a little seasoning in this world that is so bland. But what it comes down to is this, is we have to lean into Jesus and obey him and live by the Spirit, or only take his teachings as a suggestion and keep on living by the flesh. That's really the two choices. In Matthew 5, 6, and 7 is the greatest sermon you will ever hear or preach. I am way down the list on that. If you think I preached a good sermon, great. Go read the sermon of Jesus and you'll realize how mediocre my sermons are, okay, on that. But in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, this is Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. He's talking about how to play well with one another. He's talking about this Jesus ethic as to how we look at the world differently. Go back and look at it if you are a Bible-believing Christian. And he goes through all of this, and it's phenomenal, and it's tectonic shifting underneath your feet, going, whoa, I didn't realize that's really what faith was. And at the very end, he says this in Matthew chapter 7. He says, look, with everything that I've just said, if you take these teachings of mine and you put them into practice, it's like you're the wise person who built on rock, that when the storms of life come, and you know they're going to come, when the storms of life came, because you built on the foundation of my word and my ethic and my way of doing things, when the storms came, you didn't get washed away. But if you take these teachings of mine and you just kind of shrug your shoulders and you go, yeah, that's a different day and age, and these are just suggestions, and I really don't feel it, and I don't really want to know about it, I'm just going to do whatever feels good to me. Then Jesus says you're like the foolish person who built on sand, that when the storms of life popped up, you were washed away like the rest of the world, because you put your hope, this is in my interpretation, you put your hope in flesh instead of the Spirit. So how's the Holy Spirit empowering you? Some of you, I imagine, are fired up because of what's been said today, either about politics or church or family or just something. I don't know what that is. But now you have an invitation to Christian discipleship. What are you going to do about it? You going to stomp your feet? You going to go away and talk to somebody else about it? Or are you going to live into the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control? See, people get angsty about everything these days. Does that include you? I want to pray for you. Would you bow your heads and pray? Lord God, I thank you for this group. I thank you for these people. I thank you that you had each one of these people in mind before they even had it in their mind to be at church today. Lord, I thank you that you had each person in mind that are worshiping with us online, Lord. I thank you that you are part of that process of them logging in even before they realized that this was a thing. And so, Lord, I pray that each one of us today would receive that promise of your Holy Spirit. Lord, empower us, refine us, remold us, move us, Lord, so we will be known by how we follow you and not just what we believe about you. Lord, we pray specifically for the border crisis, that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we pray for this denomination, that your kingdom would come and your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray for our families, Lord, that your kingdom would come and your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, empower us to be a part of your answer to prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen. You've been given the invitation to Christian discipleship. You've got to do something with it. If you choose not to do something with it, you've already chosen what it is that you're going to do. Choose differently. Rise up out of this place as if you've been empowered by the Holy Spirit, because it's a gift that's been given to you. Now do something with it. And as you consider what that would look like, let's stand and sing our first and last verse of our closing hymn.
Dear friends, as we leave this place, what is our focus as the body of Christ? Our focus is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Amen. Go in peace.